Dear children, today we are going to read about money and credit, chapter 3 from the book of economics, class 10. In this chapter, you are going to learn modern forms of money and how they are linked with the banking system. You will also come to know about credit and how it impacts borrowers depending upon the situations. So money is an important and integral part of the economy and the growth of a country. Let us now understand what money is and what are the forms in which money is being utilized for the growth of our nation. Money is a medium of exchange. It acts as an intermediate in the exchange process. And that's why it is called a medium of exchange. A person holding money can easily exchange it for any commodity or services that he or she is interested to avail of. Now, the modern form of money is different. In early ages, Indians used grains and cattle as money. Thereafter came the use of metallic coins. But when Indians used grains and cattle as money, that was known as barter system. Once we started using metallic coins like gold, silver, copper coins, that was a phase which continued well into the last century. Now, in the modern forms of money, we have got currencies, paper notes and coins. Currency and deposits are closely linked to the working of the modern banking system. So let us understand what is currency. In India, the Reserve Bank of India issues currency notes on behalf of the central government. No other individual or organization is allowed to issue currency. The rupee is widely accepted as a medium of exchange in India. Now, the other form in which people hold money is as deposits with banks. So, currencies are deposited into banks. They deposit their extra cash with the banks by opening a bank account in their name. Banks accept the deposits and also pay an amount as interest on the deposits done by the people. These deposits in the bank accounts can be withdrawn on demand, and that is what we call it as demand deposits. The payments are made by checks instead of cash. So a check is a paper. We are now trying to understand the banking system. Check is a paper instructing the bank to pay a specific amount from the person's account to a person in whose name the check has been issued. But bank does not involve itself only in this deposits. It also has got another activity of granting the loans. Banks keep only a small proportion of their deposits as cash with themselves. These days, banks in India hold about 15% of their deposits as cash. This is kept as a provision to pay the depositors who might come to withdraw money from the bank on any given day. Normally, banks use a major portion of the deposits to extend loans. There is a huge demand for loans for various economic activities. And banks charge a higher interest rate on loans than what they offer on deposits. The difference between what is charged from borrowers and what is paid to depositors is their main source of income for banks. Now, let us understand two different credit situations. When we talk about loan, we say credit. So this credit refers to an agreement in which the lender supplies the borrower with money or with goods or services in return for the promise of future payment. So credit loan is there with a promise to get it refunded in future, with the interest levied upon the cash being given to the borrowers. Now let us take two examples which will help you to understand how credit works. Say one example is a festive season. Now what happens in this case? Salim obtains credit to meet the working capital needs of production. The credit helps him to meet the ongoing expenses of production, complete production on time, and thereby increase his earnings. In this situation, credit helps to increase earnings and therefore the person is better off than before. Now let us take up second case, Swapna's problem. In Swapna's case, what is happening? The failure of the crop made loan payment impossible. So she had to sell part of the land to repay the loan. Credit, instead of helping Swapna, improves her earnings, left her worse off. This is an example of debt trap. Credit in this case pushes the borrower into a situation from which recovery is very painful. Whether credit would be useful or not, it depends largely on the risks in the situation and whether there is some support in case of loss. So these two examples must have made clear to you that taking any loan or any money from the banks on credit has got two sides, two effects, if are not properly used or if is not being supported by the situations. Now let us understand the terms of credit. Every loan agreement specifies an interest rate which the borrower must pay to the lender along with the payment of the principal amount. In addition, lenders also demand collateral security against loans. Now, the loans cannot be granted unless there is a collateral security. What is that collateral security? It is an asset that the borrower owns. Say, for example, land, building, vehicle, livestock, or deposits with banks. They are the assets that a borrower owns. Now, the borrower uses this as a guarantee to a lender until the loan is repaid. So all these things are mortgaged or handed over to the borrower. Even the banks are the one institutions, you know, which take the mortgages and then grant the loans to the borrower. If the borrower fails to repay the loan, what happens? The lender has the right to sell the asset or collateral to obtain the payment. Now, interest rate, collateral, and documentation requirement along with the mode of payment together is called the terms of credit. Now it may vary depending on the nature of the lender and the borrower. So further, we are now proceeding to understand some of the formal sectors credits in India. They are cheap and affordable credit provider. And it is very crucial for the country's development. So the various types of loans can be grouped as formal sector loans. These are the loans from banks and cooperatives. The Reserve Bank of India supervises the functioning of formal sources of loans. Banks have to submit information to the RBI on how much they are lending, to whom are they lending, and what interest rates are they charging for the same. We call it formal sector loan. Now we are coming to the informal sector loans. These are the loans from money lenders. Some of the traders, some of the employers, relatives and friends also are there available to lend loans. There is no organization which is functional here. There is nobody to supervise the credit activities of the lenders in such sector. We call it informal sector loans. There is no one to stop them from using unfair means also to get their money back. So, when we talk about these two sectors, we also have to understand formal and informal credit and their nuances, the values. The formal sector meets only about half of the total credit needs of the rural people. The remaining credit needs are met from informal sources. it is important that the formal credit is distributed more equally so that the poor can benefit from the cheaper loans. It is necessary that banks and cooperatives increase their lending, particularly in rural areas, so that the dependence on informal sources of credit reduces. While the formal sector loans need to expand, it is also necessary that everyone receives these loans. So there has been the establishment of self-help groups for the poor. Poor households are still dependent on informal sources of credit because of various reasons. Two are very important reasons that we would like to discuss with you people today. One is the banks, which are not present everywhere in rural India, hence not accessible to the rural people. Second, even if banks are present, getting a loan from a bank is much more difficult as it requires proper documentations and collateral in some of the cases. So poor householders do not get, and they need to finally become dependent on the informal sources of the credit. In order to overcome these problems, people created self-help groups. We call it SHGs. SHG are small groups of people which promote small savings among their members. A typical SHG has 15 to 20 members, usually belonging to one neighborhood, who meet and save regularly. What are the advantages of SHG, self-help groups? It helps borrowers to overcome the problems of lack of collateral. People can get timely loans for a variety of purposes and at a reasonable interest rate. SHGs are the building blocks of organization of the rural people. It helps women to become financially self-reliant. The regular meetings of the group provide a platform to discuss and act on a variety of social issues such as health, nutrition, domestic violence, etc. We hope this audio of Chapter 3, Money and Credit, helped you in your studies. Keep learning and stay tuned for more audios with DNA Education on YouTube.